Good morning. Welcome to Collin and Curtis in the Morning. This is episode 79. I am joined, as always, by Collin Crowder, the boss man.
Ukulele has arrived at my door, but I have
Ukulele's
yet,
here.
I have yet to play Hither.
The game we've been hyping up for ages.
The game
has arrived to critical response.
You know, when I got my copy of the game, the physical copy in the mail, I was really shocked to not see us quoted on the back of the box of like hot PSNStores.com.
Yes, hot.
Yes.
This game ..
Yeah.
Looks hot.
Yes, exactly. But it was nowhere to be found, and I was just like really disappointed, but you know, I can't win them all, I guess.
I guess you can't, and neither can that game apparently. I apologize. Yeah. I haven't played it yet. I'm looking forward to like.
I'm super excited to play.
You know, it's so, in the year 2017 of our Lord, it's hard to get used to a game not being praised by everybody.
Well, I just want to clarify this for other people. When you say the year of our Lord, we're of course referring to Yoko Taro.
Yes.
Our Lord.
Yes.
Which we
it was. I mean, it's been. I feel like it's been implied. Mm-hmm. You know,
absolutely.
I feel like most people should know by now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That when I speak of God, Lord, Savior, Almighty, Alpha and Omega, it's the thing is Yoka actually stands for Alpha, Taro, Omega.
Yeah.
So
because I always thought Hideo stood for that. I always thought that's what Hideo stood for.
It's a common misconception.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So. Boy, we're dumb people,
yeah.
Huh? So, God, man, you know, I feel almost ashamed that here we are, the podcast after Ukulele's release, and neither of us have touched that game.
I know.
Essentially,
I
feel bad. I do feel bad about it, but we're going, like, at this point, like, I'm gonna play it. I haven't got around to it, but I do plan on playing it soon. Sounds like you're gonna start playing it soon.
Probably tonight as we're recording this.
Yeah, like I look forward to having conversation about that game because I feel like the reception for it, while review wise, like it's not been great, but I feel like I've seen both ends of the spectrum.
Yep.
And so like it really, I'm really curious to find out what my own thought on that game, like what my own thoughts on that game are, when I get the chance to play it, and yours as well. So
yeah.
Stay tuned to a future episode. Maybe we'll do a just ukulele spoiler cast.
I'd be good for that.
Not even spoilers, but just a lengthy conversation.
We're gonna spoil the heck out of the incredible story.
So before we get into the news, there's a couple of little house cleaning things I want to do first. First off, Collin, as we are wont to do whenever there's a Nintendo event or direct that has happened in the past week, we always bring it up because you and I, for some reason, it's all we think about, really, is Nintendo.
Pretty much.
But I just want to bring up one thing. I did something this week, Collin, that I'm not proud of.
Oh, is this the pre-order?
So, I don't remember how long ago it's been, but I made a comment on this very podcast, Collin, that I am out of the Toys to Life game. I'm out. Never going to buy another one.
Mm-hmm.
And then you said, no, you're not. You liar. And I said, nope. I promise. Collin, I gotta own up.
You pre-ordered something.
I pre-ordered something this week.
Well, I said you probably pre-ordered the Cloud Amiibos.
I pre-ordered the Cloud Amiibo, one of them.
Oh, just one of them, okay.
Yeah, the Advent Children costume one.
See, I thought you were gonna be like, I downloaded Skylanders Imaginators or something like that.
No, I pre-ordered from GameStop the Cloud Amiibo, and I'm not happy about it, but I did it.
Oh, you gotta be happy about it.
I'm gonna be happy about it on July 21st.
I haven't
when it arrives
seen,
at my door.
I haven't seen Advent Children. That's still something we talk about that we're gonna
watch
together.
Yeah, we do. We gotta put out our commentary track for Advent Children.
After I, that'd be great. After I somehow finally finish Final Fantasy VII, I haven't played it in like.
I mean, like at this point, even if it takes you a while, right? Like even if like you, it's not till the end of this year. And we watch Advent Children and put out our commentary track, it'll line up right with the release of part one of the remake. So,
oh, was that a prediction or something?
It's gonna happen. One other thing I want to mention, so Collin, I had Chinese earlier.
Okay.
And I felt like my fortune cookie was like kind of foreboding. The way I took it was like, this sounds really foreboding. Mm-hmm. Or like, this kind of sounds like the kind of thing that you don't want to see.
Okay.
Like, you go to a fortune teller or something, and they're like, they look at you and then look at the crystal ball, and they just get this look on their face, and you go, uh-oh.
Yeah, yep.
So it says, you are filled up with a sense of urgency. Be patient, or you may end up confused.
Well, thanks, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to Collin and Curtis in the Morning, episode 79. We'll see you next week.
I don't know how to take that, but keep that in the back of your mind, I guess, in your back pocket.
Okay.
Maybe it'll come back in a future episode.
You must be patient.
You must be patient, or else I'll be confused.
And let's just already admit, like, you've been a pretty patient person waiting for things like Persona 5,
yeah,
The Last Guardian, Final Fantasy versus, Final Fantasy 15.
I'd like to think so.
So I think you've already proven the fortune cookie true.
Perhaps. Yeah. I am not a confused person most of the time. Let's go ahead and hop into the news. We got some news. We're going to fly through this news this week. Most of it's just kind of small updates and release dates for things that we've talked about before. Mm-hmm. So in that regard, we'll fly through it. And then we got some games to talk about. I hope you're excited.
I'm very excited. Please be excited.
Please. So first off, Shu. No relation to Shuhei Yoshida. Nope. We may have made that joke before.
I'm sure we made it plenty of times.
Shu is coming to Vita on May 23rd. And then the PS4 version, and I assume the Vita version as well, is getting some free DLC in the form of a level pack. Mm-hmm. 6 DLC levels. Shu is a game that it's a kind of sort of time trial-y based side-scrolling platformer. In some ways reminds me of like the Rayman Origins and Legends games.
Yeah.
Just visually, it's got a sort of similar style. I think Rayman looks better. But it's a neat game. I reviewed it a few months back. So I'll link to my review in the show notes.
What Curtis is saying is that if Shu was running on UbiArt Engine, it would be incredible.
I mean, if any game was running on UbiArt Engine, it would.
I would agree with automatically that. When are we getting another UbiArt Engine game?
I would like that to know that too.
Like, it's been a while.
It's been a few years.
I mean, we had the Raymans. We had
and there was even like the reporting that
Child of Light,
Child of Light 2 was a thing.
Yeah, we had Valiant Hearts, and then it's just like we've had nothing.
All great games.
I still think those like Assassin's Creed trilogy game, whatever that was, those downloadable ones. Yeah, I thought those would have been great. In
I played like China, the first one, and I thought it was all right.
See, there's been many times I've almost bought that. I think it's been on some sales or flash sales. I almost even bought it on Vita. I think once to play it on my PSTV, but.
They're not like amazing, or like the first one wasn't amazing, but I thought it was all right, and it was like an interesting adjustment of mechanics to a 2D side-scrolling game. Yeah. And so I was like, this is interesting. Like, I don't think this is interesting.
Yeah, sure. And I mean, even with that, just like the Russian one was the only one that really even interested me anyways.
Sure,
mostly.
Sure.
Yeah.
So then TumbleSeed is coming out May 2nd for PS4. This is a roly roguelike. You know what it kind of reminds me of in a weird way? I don't know what they're called. They're these little physical, like, kind of toys. They're these maze, like, wooden mazes that you can kind of tip around. There's, like, a marble inside.
Oh,
and you kind of
try
to guide it around the maze, but in the maze there are these little holes that it can fall through. So you're trying to avoid the holes, too. So just watching the trailer, like, it's rolling up and down, like, this kind of procedurally generated thing, and there's these little holes that you're avoiding.
Yeah.
There's other thing, you know, there's other like power-ups and monsters you're fighting too, but it just reminded me of that when I saw it, or whenever I see it.
I don't know how hot I am on the game from what I've seen. One thing that I really do like is they talk about how you use both of the analog sticks to balance the seed. Because when I first saw this, I was like, oh, this is going to be some motion-controlled, you know, motion back and forth with the... DualShock 4 6-axis thing, whatever. I really thought that was like what this game was gonna be, and then they're like, no, you use both sticks, and I was like, oh, thank you. But yeah, I don't I don't know. It just doesn't hit all that much for me.
I think it looks interesting. It's just, I don't know. It's one. I feel like it's something I need to get my hands on to really have any sort of thing to say about it. Because, like,
yeah,
it looks interesting. I just don't really know what to think of it just yet. And roguelikes, I'm still kind of acclimatizing to.
When I first saw them talking about TumbleSeed, I was like, didn't that game come out? And I was like, oh, I'm thinking of TumbleStone.
Oh, no. Well, TumbleSeed, to be fair, is one of those games where I feel like it just pops up every few months.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it looks good. I think it looks really good, but I don't know about game-wise.
Speaking of a game that also just kind of pops up every few months, and you're reminded of, and you're like, all right, that exists. And it's also a game you roll around in, Deformers.
Oh, that's right.
Is coming out on April 21st to PS4. So we've talked about a lot that's from the Order 1886 team.
Yeah, very similar.
Developer, very similar games.
Yeah, and they made God of War before that and all that, yeah.
Yeah, I do wonder what they'll end up doing after this, or like if they have some other bigger project in the works, or if it's just been Deformers.
Yeah, I just don't really see this game really hitting all that hard. The only thing I feel like that could like really kind of start this game is like the streamer crowd. Like I think probably PC it might get some people going. It's priced at $30, which I don't know, just from what I had seen, I maybe seems like a little steep.
Yeah,
but I don't know. I mean, I don't want to degrade it by saying that it looks like a PS Plus game that would be free for the month and everyone would get on and play multiplayer, but that's just kind of what it reminds me of.
It's just, I don't know. We've seen it. Neither of us have played it, I don't think, to be fair, but
no.
I feel like I have a decent understanding of what it is. I just, I don't know. Every time I see it, I just like, I don't know. Like, I'm curious about it, and I would like to play a little bit of it, but I just don't know if it's something that really is going to latch onto me in any way.
Yeah, and I don't know how. I don't think like GameStop has been pushing this game as much as like they did Song of the Deep.
I don't know. Sometimes I feel like I see little ads in my GameStop for it.
Yeah, I see ads, but like I remember like with Song of the Deep, they had like the vinyl pop figures.
Yeah, they had a lot of figurines.
Books, they had cards, T-shirts.
Well, maybe come April 21st, maybe there's going to be little Deformer plushies and stress balls and whatever.
I'm a Deformer. I don't know. I don't know.
You're a Deformer now. I'm a Deformer now. You're... See, it doesn't roll off the tongue the way Squid does.
There also is a $40 collector's edition with a physical copy of the game, steelbook, and soundtrack. It is composed by Austin Wintory, which I think that's kind of cool.
Yeah, that is cool.
Yeah. But I don't really see myself playing this much.
All right, so moving on. Deemo, spelled D-E-E-M-O, The Last Recital, is coming to PlayStation Vita on April 18th.
Mm-hmm.
So a digital-only game is going to be $15. It's described as a hybrid rhythm game, which I don't know what the hybrid part really stands for. Looks like it just looks like a rhythm game to me. Yeah. It's got some like interesting, I'm assuming is in the game from the trailer, like these interesting like 2D scenes between this like girl and this... I don't know if monster is the right word.
Yeah.
This paranormal entity, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. There's from the overview, Deemo is a mystic character. Oh, there we go. So it's named Deemo, who lives in solitude in a castle all by itself. A little girl falls from the sky, not knowing who she is, where she comes from. To help the little girl back to her world, Deemo comes to realize a tree keeps growing tall on top of the piano whenever it plays. So yeah, and it's an interesting looking rhythm game. So I kind of want to check it out. I don't know. I watched the trailer, a couple of trailers for it. It looks interesting to me.
When I Google and like I look at like developers and like publishers for it, I get like a different name. But the Twitter account PM Studios has been tweeting a lot about this game.
Okay.
And you may know PM Studios, at least I know them from the Vita game Super Beat Zonic.
Oh.
So I don't know if this is like the same team or maybe they're just publishing.
Okay.
This game. But yeah, it's, I guess some part of this game is by the same people that did Super Beat Zonic.
Which is a game that you reviewed.
I really did. I really reviewed that. I really reviewed that. It was a game I really enjoyed. I thought it was a really cool Vita game. There was a lot of like DLC that came with it too. I think some free, some downloadable. There was a lot of I think there was like a Guilty Gear song in there. Like there were some guest songs that popped up there. But
hey game. Colin.
Hey Curtis. Hey Pikmin.
Hey Pikmin. I mean, I guess it's a neat name for that, whatever. August, the release calendar for August is starting to fill out.
It is.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff. So what do we got so far? We got, like, Middle-Earth Shadow of War.
We got Agents of Mayhem.
Yeah, we got two games we're talking about, I believe, that are
and
coming
in August.
And then
we got two new games to add to that list. Are you ready?
Yes, we do. Yes.
Yakuza Kiwami.
What does Kiwami mean? Does that just mean like original or something?
We talked about this, and I'm trying to remember.
It was like a PSX or something. I don't remember though.
We talked about it when I talked about Yakuza Zero after reviewing that game. Mm-hmm. It's a remake of the first game, and I think Kiwami might translate to that or something like a remake or something of that sort. This is coming out August 29th for PS4. It is going to be $30.
That's a great price.
Super, like I'm awesome price. Yeah, great price. I wonder if it was priced similarly when it came out in Japan. I don't know for sure.
Yeah.
Because Yakuza Zero, I believe, was $60 when it came out over here. So I wonder. I don't know. I wonder what the reasoning was for pricing it that low. I guess.
Yeah.
Because I do believe it is getting a physical release, so it's not like it's digital only or anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's like a. They talk about like.
Yeah. There's that slick cover. It actually looks similar. Too. To the Persona 5 steelbook cover, it's a really slick steelbook, but then the kind of transparent cover for the steelbook, it has some additional artwork that kind of like goes over it,
mm-hmm.
and like adds a little extra flair to it. It looks nice. Yeah. So this one looks nice too.
I've never been. I'll just say sorry. I haven't really been into Yakuza. Like I've. They talk about it at, like, every PSX. It seems like, hey, here's your, like, Yakuza release, North American release update.
Sure.
And I'm just like, I don't really know. But just hearing, like, especially you and a lot of people talking about
it. I was going to say, if only there was somebody to, like, tell you the good news about Yakuza.
I hear a lot about Yakuza 0, and that kind of makes me want to try that game out.
You should. You like, really kind of should.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All
right. Deathstate. Coming to PS4 in April. Oh, well, we should do the other August game. Sorry.
Yes.
Uncharted The Lost Legacy.
The Lost Legacy.
The Lost King. What did we call Jack?
we called the Jack and Daxter game The Lost Legacy. But it's The Lost Frontier. I'm glad we caught that.
Uncharted The Lost Legacy is coming to PS4 on August 22nd. It's going to be, what, $40?
I believe so, yes.
And if you pre-order, guess what you get with it?
Ratchet and Clank.
No, well, no. You get Jack and Daxter, the Precursor Legacy.
Oh, that's right.
So you can get the Lost Legacy and the Precursor Legacy.
Yeah.
Anyways, that should be exciting. They have a new video of it, some new footage. Mm-hmm. I refuse to watch it. I'm like, I've seen enough. I'm good.
I did watch it. It looked fine. It was just a like a cutscene.
Oh, I'm sure.
Probably.
I wonder how long that game's gonna be. Like,
they talk about that it's gonna be like substantial. I think like a long time ago they made some quote, or like around PSX they made a quote that like it's gonna be longer than Left Behind but shorter than Uncharted 4, which like is a wide range.
Yeah, because like Left Behind was like 2 hours, and then Uncharted 4, we're looking at 15 to 16. Perhaps.
Yeah, I'd say maybe like 5, 6. I'd say maybe, it might be longer than that. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, cool, though. I'm really, really looking forward to it.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where I feel like it's going to fly under the radar for me, personally. Yeah. And then it will come out, and it will be like, oh, man, this is amazing. It's incredible.
It will. So I guess like it was probably would have been a good thing to pick up. I guess if you picked up the Uncharted 4, like Explorer Pack.
Yeah, that season pass thing.
Yeah, you're gonna get Lost Legacy, I believe, just free download. Mm-hmm. Which is really cool.
Presumably, Jack and Daxter also.
So they. It says owners of these products are not eligible for any pre-order bonuses. So if you have the Explorers Pack, Digital Deluxe Edition, or Triple Pack of A Thief's End, yeah, because the last line of like the blog post says owners of these products are not eligible for any pre-order bonuses.
Oh, never mind then. So,
but you are getting, but you would get all of that Uncharted 4 DLC, and you would be getting, Lost Legacy for like $10 cheaper.
Okay.
So like, but then in turn you could just use that $10 and just probably buy Jack PS2 when it comes out. So
okay.
I don't know. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you should buy Jack anyways.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm just not
so big of a Jack guy. Two last stories I want to get through real quick. Deathstate is coming to PS4 on April 25th because apparently there's not enough games coming out on April 25th.
Yeah.
That game is a bullet hell shmup, but also a roguelike.
Yeah.
And the thing about it is you're shooting all of the time, no matter what.
Oh, okay.
So you're not using a right analog stick to aim. It's just auto-locking onto the nearest enemy.
That's kind of cool.
And so you're more concerned about maneuvering around enemies and dodging and weaving.
Mm-hmm.
Which I thought was like, okay, that's an interesting take on it. Yeah. And then also with it being roguelike, it reminded me of, like, your Binding of Isaacs, your, those sorts of games.
They all kind of look the same after a while.
Yeah.
It's like a Nuclear Throne.
Level design, not so much Binding of Isaac, I guess. I don't want to, like, attribute every roguelike to Binding of Isaac. That's my fault. Whatever. It looks interesting. The Sun is getting VR support on April 18th, and something called Sunrise Mode.
Yeah. So I guess, like, Sunrise is, it's kind of like a, I don't know, like a chill mode or whatever, but it's kind of like a, I don't think you can't die or whatever. Like, it talks about it doesn't have high scores and the difficulty doesn't get high, you know, difficulty just doesn't increase.
Zen mode.
Kind of, very much so, yes. That's a good word to. But yeah, it's more of a Zen mode. But yeah, I really think it'd be really cool to play this game in VR.
Sure.
I have not. I don't. Was this a free PS Plus game at one point?
At one point, I believe it was. I know I have it. I don't remember buying it.
Yeah. So. I wonder if it was. You know, it's not like I update a PS Plus list every month or anything. Sometimes.
But you really should.
Yeah, I think this was free at one point. But yeah, I really kind of wanted to try this in VR. I didn't really care for like the kind of what like the Race the Sun was going for. But yeah, they're showing like the VR support, the Sunrise mode. I think it looks really cool. I think I'd probably try it out.
So yeah. And Colin, before we get to the games we've been playing, I got in my earpiece, I'm hearing from our overlord, Yoko Taro, late-breaking news.
Mm-hmm.
Colin, are you there?
Yes, I am here. Is the Lord communicating well with you?
Yes, we have late-breaking news on a highly anticipated video game that we got a release date for this past week.
Okay.
Still vague on some details. We don't have a U.S. release date, but we do have a Japanese release date for this game. It does seem to be real, and we've seen some footage of it, and it looks great.
Are there dragons?
There are indeed dragons. We did see a dragon boss fight. I can't confirm. Dragons are confirmed. Check that box.
Okay. Are there quests?
Potentially quests. It does seem like the characters will be going on a quest.
Okay. Good. Is this the 11th one they've made?
There's been lots of spinoffs, but yes, 11 does. The XI does appear in the title. Of course, referencing Roman numerals, obviously.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So of course we're talking about Dragon Quest XI. Yes. This game is coming out in Japan on July 29th.
That's really quick. That's really soon. That's like
on
3 months.
PS4 and 3DS are both coming out the same day. Yeah. So we we got a bunch of footage from both versions. Mm-hmm. And so here's my approach to this is with it, I kind of figured it was coming out soon, or sooner than you might expect, considering what we had seen prior to this. The event that they held on, it was like Monday night, or I guess it was Tuesday afternoon for them, but it was like, I guess it was like 1 a.m. Tuesday for me or something. Mm-hmm. And I just figured it was coming out sooner than you would expect. But also the thing that gives me hope, because I do think they're going to localize this. Obviously, they're not going to announce it there. I even think an E3 announcement might be a pipe dream.
Yeah.
For Dragon Quest, I think that's a best case scenario. Although, to be fair, Dragon Quest Builders, that localization was, if not at E3, it was like the week of E3.
Yeah.
So they've done it before. I think that's best case scenario. And my hope is that it's not going to be a lengthy localization process. Like, my hope is, like, this is the game that's been in development a while. My hope would be that they had been working on the localization throughout that, at least in some form. With it being late July, I still do not think that there is a chance at all that this reaches any other, like, I don't think it's coming over to the U.S. this year. But I kind of, like, there's a little, like, I think best case scenario is, like, maybe early next year. And which would, you know, give it, like, a 7, 8, maybe 9 month window. It'd be hard, like, you can't really compare it to, like, Dragon Quest Heroes or Builders. Because even those were, they were kind of extended periods as well. But they're obviously not going to be nearly as big as Dragon Quest XI will be. But that said, they showed footage of, like, the game. I don't know if you've watched this yet. It's, like, it's interesting. It was interesting watching that. In, like, the 40-minute break I took from Persona 5, basically. Because here's Persona 5, this, like, really stylish and kind of, I guess, up-to-date kind of game. Like, you think 2017, like, just UI-wise, like, everything about it is like, seems like fresh and innovative and interesting, and there's a lot of like just quality of life improvements in Persona 5 that like makes it really fun, to like a lot better to just to play in general compared to previous entries. Whereas Dragon Quest has been a series that's known for being kind of sticking with tradition, and there are some people who aren't fans of that, and like that's not necessarily a good or bad thing. I think that there are things about its reliance on tradition that I like a lot. And there are other things that I look at and I think, well, you could break away from that now. Like, I think it wouldn't hurt you to maybe do some things different. In some ways. Like, one way, it's the menu. When you open up the menu, it's like the same menu it's always been. And it's like, I mean, that's fine. It works. And there's not necessarily anything wrong with it. But, you know, you could update that, too.
There's horse racing in this game.
That's right. And you know what else is in this game that hasn't been in the Dragon Quest game?
I see slot machines.
Uh-huh. Oh, dude.
So you can gamble away all your money.
Don't get me started on casinos in Dragon Quest.
Okay.
Oh, I've spent untold amount of time in Dragon Quest casinos. You can jump. There's a jump button.
Oh, there's a jump button.
There's a jump button. You can jump in this game.
See, like, side note.
Yeah.
Is there a jump button in Zelda Breath of the Wild?
There is.
That's mind-blowing to me.
Right?
Like, I didn't know that until, like,
maybe like, it like doesn't seem that crazy, but
yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
And this is the thing. Like, I was thinking about it was Dragon Quest. Like, when they started jumping, it was like, oh, my God.
Yeah.
I mean, there, you know, Dragon Quest Heroes, there's a jump button. But like and Builders also, but in a mainline Dragon Quest game, like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
And because also when you think about like just dungeon design, level design wise, like those are in a lot of JRPGs, when you can't jump most of the time, or when you do, it's like specific button prompts when you reach certain ledges. So like Persona 5, there's a lot of really flashy like jumping and leaping across ledges, but it's always when you're standing right there.
Yeah.
Right, so you don't have direct control over it. You're just hitting a button and something flashy happens and you're like, oh, that's awesome, that looks so cool. But and because you're stuck to the ground, like, the levels are designed in that respect. They're not designed with the idea of you can jump to this ledge
Yeah.
And so the fact that there was jumping in this game, they showed it in the town. You could, like, they were jumping on barrels to get to the roof of, like, a building to, like, to then find a treasure chest there. And so, like, it seems like such a small thing, but especially for Dragon Quest, it's kind of, it's sort of a big deal. So they showed a little bit of just walking around with one of the initial party members of, it looked like your hometown. The setup for this game is extremely, like, a lot of Dragon Quest games, story-wise, have pretty general, like, kind of sort of generic JRPG setups of, like, you're the chosen one or whatever. So this one is very much like you come to find that you're the reincarnation of a hero. Tell me if this rings a bell.
Sure.
And so then you, like, you and your best friend who you've grown up with, you and her, you both, you're born on the same day, and so you have your adulthood ceremony on the same day, and you go out onto adventure. But typically, like, Dragon Quest for me has been about the characters, but also there are stories for Dragon Quest that, like, are really interesting and really well done, even if they start at places that seem generic. We don't know a lot about that yet. It does seem like, seems like it's actually tying into some earlier Dragon Quest games, which is kind of interesting. But then they showed a dungeon, and they showed some combat. So, and that's, like, the main thing I want to talk about. So there was one thing, they were in, like, a volcano-looking area. They fought this enemy that was, like, was some sort of monster, like, in a mech suit. So they fought it, killed the monster, and then the main character jumped into the mech suit and started walking around the dungeon in this, like, mech, and it was like pushing boulders to create bridges over, like, the gaps in the lava, and doing other things. And it was like, it's just one thing, right? But you can imagine, like, what other kind of weird things can you do like that in dungeons? Like, what other things will you be able to jump and pilot around? So, like, that was really cool to see. The combat system on the PS4 version, it's really interesting. You can do it traditionally where you're kind of, your party is lined up in a line and you're facing off against whatever enemies, and it's turn-based, whatever you, however you play it. But there's another option where you can freely roam around the battlefield, and when you actually do your attack, it's still turn-based. You're still accessing menus. But the difference is you're actually freely moving around. And in that mode, I don't know if it's going to be this, I'm curious to see how it works, because in that mode, it seemed like positioning mattered. So if you, like, hit an enemy from the backside, you know, like, you think about a lot of tactics games where it's like, yeah, you hit him from the back, you do more damage. But if the bosses and enemies are balanced in that respect, I wonder if it's going to work differently between the two battle modes. Since, like, if you're just lined up in front of the enemy, you're not going to be able to, like, I can do a back attack now.
Yeah.
So I'm curious how that works. I don't, there's kind of a language barrier, so I don't really know. They have, like, a collector's edition that comes with both versions of the game, both PS4 and 3DS, which is kind of nuts. They show the box art. Box art looks great.
Any chance that comes west?
No way. Not that specific collector's edition. I don't think so. I would love it. That'd be great.
So, but, like, I saw that, and I saw people were, like, tweeting about it, and I was like, what are they talking about? And then, like, it hit me. I was like, oh, like, this is one collector's edition. Like, I didn't, I wasn't, like,
and I didn't realize, like, I didn't realize that as well until people who, like, know Japanese were tweeting, no, listen, this is, this is crazy. I'm curious how this localization is going to be handled, especially announcement-wise, because it is, like, it's on PS4, but it's also on 3DS, and I don't know, I feel like there's a, I feel like PS4-wise, like, it's coming over. 3DS, I feel like maybe has a lesser of a chance, I'm not really sure.
So is this, this get confirmed for Switch as well,
or? Yes, but they're not talking much about it. That's not going to be be out in July.
Okay, gotcha.
So no one really knows too much about what's going on there. I don't know, it looks really good. I'm really I'm super excited. I mean, Dragon Quest VIII is my favorite game, period. And this is, like, this is the Dragon Quest I have wanted ever since finishing Dragon Quest VIII.
Good.
So I'm excited. I hope the wait isn't too long. It's going to be really hard to like not import that game.
Yeah, you're gonna have other stuff to.
Yeah, you're right.
There's like the Ni No Kunis coming out.
You're right, Ni No Kuni 2.
Before that, yeah.
Very excited. Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of games, we've been playing some.
A few.
Just a little bit. I want to start with one. I haven't played much of this, but I want to talk about it. Okay. If you will let me.
I suppose so.
Okay. So I've been playing Cosmic Star Heroine. I'm about 90 minutes in.
Okay.
So not very far. I got just a few things I want to say, really. I'm not far enough to really talk much about story or characters, because I really kind of don't know what the story setup is for this. And that might sound weird being 90 minutes into this game. You have this, like, the opening is like it's like Alicia LaSalle or something is her name. And she kind of goes in. So it's like it's made by Zaboy Games. They did the Penny Arcade, JRPG, the episode 3 and episode 4. On the Rain's Look, Precipice of Darkness. They made some other kind of indie JRPG-inspired games like Breath of Death and Cthulhu Saves the World. And this was a Kickstarter game. It's definitely their biggest game that they've done. Been working on it for a few years now. And it very much is clear inspiration from like Chrono Trigger, I guess Phantasy Star is another one people have been throwing around. I'm more familiar with Chrono Trigger. But it's like this sci-fi kind of JRPG game. And the opening is like you're going into this like hostage situation where you're like going into this area, you fight some enemies, you're getting ready to free the hostages, so you learn that they've rigged a bomb to blow up. And so you like the one person you've teamed up with, you're like, okay, you go free the hostages, I'll take care of the bomb. You go defuse the bomb. And then you go back to your headquarters and like, okay, we got a new mission for you. And so I'm out doing the mission they've sent me on now, which is like this other planet where this like terrorist organization that people didn't know were active anymore. We got reports that they were active again and they're doing some shady stuff. So we're sent to investigate basically. So I feel like I'm getting close to maybe getting to the point where the game's going to be like, okay, here's kind of the general setup. I think I have an ideal, like, I'm pretty sure this is a game where you get, like, betrayed early on, and it's about proving that you are innocent kind of deal.
Mm-hmm.
It's the hunch that I have, because it definitely gives, you get the feeling that not everything is as it seems right now. Sure. But, so there's that stuff. I'm not far enough to really have any sort of thoughts on that at all. But, what I want to talk about. One, the game looks nice. It's all pixel art. It looks really good. The music is good, too. I quite like the music I've heard so far.
Okay. Is it like a synth kind of?
Yeah, so it's something like Hyper Duck. I don't remember the last word. They worked on Dust and Elysian Tale.
Oh, okay.
Was another game that they did the soundtrack for, so.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to talk about the combat system in this game, because it's really good.
Okay.
So it's turn-based. It's a pretty traditional turn-based JRPG. On the right-hand side, you've got like a little bar which shows you icons for each character and enemy, so you kind of know the turn order for the combat. But the way it starts out is every battle, you have your HP. You don't have MP or anything like that. So you have a set of skills. You have your skills, you have your items, and other different like special abilities for each character. And all of those are kind of refreshed at the start of every battle. So unlike other RPGs or JRPGs, where it's like, oh, well, I have a certain amount of MP. And that doesn't recharge after every fight, so I've got to carry around potions or ethers to recharge my MP, right? And so typically you might be going through a dungeon, and you know there's a boss coming up. So it's like, well, I don't want to really be using any of my big attacks right now, or my good magic ability, because I want to save it for the boss fight. So in this game, it recharges after every fight. And so every single fight, you start with everything, which I love. Because what that means is that means like every single fight, because it also it's a game where the fights are taking place just in the world themselves, like Chrono Trigger, and so there are just limited fights basically.
There's not like these pre-rendered backgrounds.
No, and there's no random encounters or anything.
Yeah.
And so as you're exploring, you'll just see some monsters running, like just kind of walking around, and as you approach them, you'll trigger a fight. I Am Setsuna is also a similar in that respect, but because there's limited fights and because the developers can know going in, when you get into these fights, your HP is maxed out and you just have all of your skills and items available to you, they can be balanced in that respect. So it's one of those things where like every single fight, they matter more. I think in a lot of JRPGs, like early on, it's like, okay, I'll go through and I'll do these fights and I'll actually care about what I'm doing. But as you get farther into the game, it's like, well, I can just kill these guys really quick, or I just don't really care, so I'm just going to be mashing the attack button really fast, just to fast forward all through like through these kind of fodder enemies just to get to the next mini boss or the next big boss fight. And at least thus far, it seems like this is the game that is designed around making every single fight interesting, which you really can't say about a lot of JRPGs. Like even Persona 5, it gets to the point where like a lot of your kind of basic enemy encounters are like, okay, let's get through this, right? So what's interesting, so like for instance, you have, other than like a very basic attack skill, all of your skills have a number of uses per fight. So I'm early on, so right now they're like one use a piece, so there's that. But if you use a skill, like let's say I use like my water magic for my main character, I can spend a turn recharging any skills I've used. There's also this system called Hyper. And so what Hyper is at the start of the battle, I'll use the main character as an example. At the start of every fight, on her second turn, she enters a Hyper stance. And what that basically means is that her attacks are going to be much stronger on that turn. And then after that initial Hyper stance, it'll be like every three turns for her. So what that does is that not only are you considering like, okay, what is the turn order? When is the next enemy going to attack? Maybe this particular enemy that I know is very strong, when are they going to attack? I need to consider that. But also consider like, because you have limited uses for skills, and it's always going to be the same for every battle, like, you consider, okay, well, maybe I should hold this one and wait until I enter Hyper stance, because you want to get the most out of these skills. There's also a style mechanic, and so as the battles go on, your characters and the enemies are getting stronger with every turn. So any move you use is going to increase your style by some percentage. It starts out at 0. So a lot of moves, it's like 25 or 35%, depending on the move you do. And as it gets larger, you just inherently get stronger, but that also works for the enemies as well. And so it's the kind of deal where I've been in a fight earlier, before we recorded, where there were particular enemies that for them, it was, as the fight went on, they got faster. And so it was the kind of thing was like, you wanted to ensure that you killed them as quickly as possible. To ensure that they weren't getting two or three turns between each of your turns. So it's very strategic, and it seems designed in such a way, like I said before, where every single fight, even just kind of very basic enemies, is going to matter. And that has me really excited. So I'm playing on the second highest. There's four difficulties. I'm playing on Heroine, which I just assume is kind of your normal difficulty from reading from the sounds of it. You can change it at any time, which I like. You can save it any time, which I also really like. It's great so far. I'm really enjoying it. Sounds like it's maybe under 20 hours to complete, which I'm happy about considering I just came off Persona 5. But I'm super into it so far. And the combat seems to be, like, the music's been good. I think it is a good looking game pixel art wise. Nothing to say about the story yet, but if nothing else, like, the combat is really impressive, especially as like an indie kind of JRPG. It's really promising thus far. Mm-hmm. So I'll have more to say about that soon. I'm going to review it hopefully in the next week or so. Hopefully even, honestly, like, hopefully in the next day or so, I'll have a review up for it.
Yeah, I'd like to start it. I have it downloaded too. Yeah.
Would
you say it's a, like, I like the smaller scale, like, RPG, JRPG stuff.
It seems
so that way. Like, okay. So like what I mean by that is like, I really like, you know, we talked about like the Paper Mario, Mario and Luigi stuff. But one I really liked, I don't remember what your thoughts on it was, but I really like the Dragon Fantasy.
Okay.
Book 1 and 2.
I didn't necessarily play much of the first one.
Okay.
I think in that respect you might like these. Like, this definitely, like, there's a lot of strategy involved, but you can, there's also like, if you're having a hard time, there are difficulties that you can kind of attune yourself to.
Sure.
I don't think there's any trophies tied to difficulty, which I
okay.
I really like, actually. Like, it depends on the game, I think. Mm-hmm. But I do appreciate when games are like, don't worry about it. Just play how you want to play.
Yeah.
I do like that quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Even Persona does the same, which I liked as well. Cause like that game has some, its hardest difficulty is it's kind of nuts.
Yeah.
But that's what I got to say about that game. I just want to say that real quick. Let's maybe bounce to you and then we can bounce back to me.
Okay.
As well.
I do have a, oh man, I just looked this up. I was going to say a quick PSA
mm-hmm.
to remind people about the Humble THQ Nordic bundle.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was going to remind them about that, but yes. Apparently it's going to end in 3 days, 13 hours as of us recording this on a Friday.
Well, so it ends on the 18th.
So yeah.
So this will go, when this goes up, okay, there's still like a day left.
Yeah, you'd still have a little bit left.
But we have a big correction to make. Oh right? Yes, I forgot about yes. this.
Oh, massive one.
I was wondering yes. what this update was for.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, it's just a little bit of that, and then another little thing I was going to talk about. Just going to just briefly touch on RBI Baseball. Last week I'll take out we. You're not responsible for this. Mm-hmm. I'm responsible for this.
Nope.
I said that the game did not have local multiplayer, and even in my gameplay glimpse, I corrected myself. The game does have local multiplayer. Where I got confused was when you click on Exhibition in previous years, and I even downloaded RBI 16 to look at this, it usually said next to the CPU, it said Player 2, press Options, and then your Player 2 would go in there. So the funny thing is that was nowhere to be seen in RBI 17. Like, nowhere on there did it say Player 2, press Options to play. So I thought I messed around with it with another controller just to see, but I guess maybe I didn't accidentally hit Options or something. It didn't work. So then the new update just came out for RBI 17 that added the online multiplayer mode.
Okay.
And so I did try multiple times at different times of the day to try to find an online ranked game for RBI 17, and I did not find one game. but then I was about to close out of the game, and I had my little curiosity. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go to Exhibition real quick.
Okay.
And I click Exhibition, and then right next to the CPU, it said, Player 2, press Start for multiplayer or whatever. And I'm like, oh, they just added that in.
Well, so I was going to say, are you sure this isn't, instead of a correction, it's more of a, hey, they added this within the update?
No, because I had actually
originally... You sure it wasn't in there before?
No, because I had tried the local before the update. The update that the video gameplay glimpse that is on the site and
YouTube.com/PSNStores,
that was before the update, okay. and I clarify it
in the video enough.
As well. So yeah, that was before that.
So what other weird hijinks with RBI Baseball have you gotten into?
Not really. I just need to play. I need to play probably just like one more game and just like review it.
Just wanted to clarify the multiplayer shenanigans. Yes.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I did just kind of want to touch on, like, yeah, there's no one playing RBI. Okay. And even, I think I mentioned, maybe it was last week or even in the video, that it's like, if you were going to play RBI online, the only reason to do that would just be because, like, hey, if your friend decided to, you know, get the game as well, then you could play each other online, like an invite friend kind of thing.
Yeah.
I almost thought about inviting you to like an RBI, like, you know, or it'd be like all caps or whatever. It'd be like, hey, Boss Fantasy Crowder wants you to play RBI 17 with him. And I was like, I thought about just sending that, you to that, but you know, you weren't online at the time, so.
Oh, I've.
Guess you're not going to play RBI Baseball.
I probably was online at the time.
Oh, you were? Uh-huh. Oh, you were? Are you just invisible?
I've been appearing offline for about a week and a half now.
Really?
Yeah. Oh,
do you have a reason for that?
I do. I don't know. It's sometimes you
Curtis,
just like...
Curtis, have you been playing Senran Kagura?
No, I've been playing Persona 5. And... I was getting like messages and stuff, and I was like, I don't want to, sure. I don't want to ignore it and then feel bad. Yeah. So I was like, whatever, I'll just appear on offline and make my way through this game, and then magically reappear now that I'm outside of that bubble. But we'll get to that because you've been playing another game online, I would assume.
Yeah.
I have this downloaded.
We haven't talked about this at all.
I have it downloaded. I was going to play a couple matches before we recorded, but I didn't have time to.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to know your thoughts on this.
We were, of course, referring to the new PlayStation Plus game for the month of April, also known as David Jaffe's new project.
David Jaffe presents Drawn to Death.
David Jaffe's Drawn to Death. From the makers of Calling All Cars comes Drawn to Death.
Is it that specific team?
I don't know. No, it's probably not the specific team. Did I say team?
Studio or whatever?
No, it's like a different company. Did I say team that brought you?
Yeah.
Anyways,
Drawn to Death.
Yeah, I doubt it's the same team.
How's this game?
I'm really confused by it. Uh-oh. I'm probably going to have like a lot of this like, stops in my sentences because on one end I really like this game,
okay,
and then on another end I really don't like
so let's
game.
Maybe let's do it this way. Let's start here. I'm gonna interview you.
Yes, that would
Colin,
be probably the best way to
what do you
this.
How what do you like about this game?
I think Drawn to Death plays really well.
Okay, what do you mean by that?
I think especially the big thing that stands out to me is the movement in the game. I really like fast-paced shooters, so I would say I am definitely a more like Call of Duty person instead of a Battlefield person.
Okay.
I love Titanfall 2, like those kind of fast-paced shooters. So I really think in that respect, I think Drawn to Death moves and flows like really, really. I wouldn't say like the best ever, but I think it plays really well. I think even the characters, and I think there's like character specific. There's different like characters, and they each have their own specials and stuff like that. I think there might be six or seven. I've only played, I think, maybe three so far.
Okay.
And even just what I've played, I feel like they're just each individually pretty well crafted, like with their each unique things. Like so, like the L1 button is different for every character. They have two different specials, and I think there might even be something else as well. But like, there's definitely a thing that's like. When you see somebody, you're like, oh, so-and-so's this character. And you're like, oh, I'm probably going to have to watch out for that.
What are specific abilities are we talking?
So you kind of have, like, one that's like, hey, this guy can turn invisible kind of thing. There's, like, this teddy bear, kind of sadistic teddy bear. Like, he can go invisible. You know, a lot of games have done stuff like that. But he's also got, like, one of his specials is that he can, like, fly around the map with a chainsaw and just like go after people, which is kind of cool.
Naturally, as you do.
but like one of the other ones, I think his name was he's like the main character you play as Johnny Savage, I believe is his name.
Okay.
He's like in, and it's just kind of like a basic ability that you've seen before, but like he can start like playing guitar, and if you like, they've got like this kind of circle around him, like this big kind of sphere. And, you know, if you get enemies inside the sphere, it can do, like, a lot of damage or potentially, like, kill enemies.
Okay.
So, like, one that I really like is, I don't remember names specifically, but there's one with, like, a shark head or something like that. It's, like, some female with, like, a shark head on it. And it's got, like, an anchor. So, like, if people are, like, trying to run away or if they're, like, in the air, I think, or something like that, you can, like, throw an anchor at them and they'll literally just, like, be tied down. Like to the ground and just be stuck where you can just kind of wail on them.
Okay.
It's just little things like that I think are pretty cool. There's another character that like has a whip you can hit players with. I think it's arrow-like, and she's got like a hat that's like made of spikes, and you can throw that. And they like talk about that, like, hey, if you throw this hat, it will do like a certain amount of damage if it actually hits them when you throw it,
mm-hmm.
but it will actually do more damage when it comes back to you. Like, so, when it returns, it'll do even more damage.
So when this game was announced, one of the aspects about it that really caught my attention, and it's a thing that throughout, ever since then, it's like the one thing about this game that I've latched onto, with the thought being, well, that could potentially be really interesting, is mm-hmm. the look of the game. The kind Absolutely. Of the concept of aesthetically, we're looking at like some high school kid's notebook sitting in the back yeah. of the class just drawing random doodles. In practice, how does that look in game? Do you think in practice that is pulled off very well?
I think that what you just described specifically, I think that aspect is correct. I think that looks like doodles from an eighth grader or okay. something like that, you know, or whatever. Like, it but looks like that.
But is it good? Do you like that?
I think, well, the game is fine. I think it's good. It's just, I think, and this is one of the things I want to touch on, I feel like and it's just pretty much putting it out there, I think the image of this game is just so, I don't know if I want to say bad, but it's like so off track.
Expand upon this if you can.
I feel like this game could have been so much more with this art style. So you're getting to that point where, and I'm sure people have seen it, I think you've seen it, it's just very juvenile, very uh-huh. immature. There's like, I'll get back to the point, but like, there's like GIFs of like, you know, very, very vulgar kind of things with like poop and dicks and all that stuff that it's just like, why is this here?
Uh-huh.
And so there's a lot of that in kind of, I believe, some of the drawings and especially a lot of the writing as well. So you have like character specific writings, so like each character will say something that they repeat a million times. And then there's also this commentator that just goes on and on. Side note, thankfully you can turn off that commentator because it just never shuts up about
okay.
whatever it wants to talk about. So, but as like as looking at that game as like, I have never seen a game like this before. And mm-hmm. the more I think about it, I'm just like, this game, like without that vulgarness stuff in there, I feel like this game could have been really special. I even think, and maybe this is even too much like stretch, too much far of a stretch, but like if they would have, instead of it being a multiplayer only game and like starting out as a free to play game, if they like built this game up of like, hey, here's this eighth grader's notebook, drawing and doodles and stuff, and like here's the story that happens inside of it, or you know, like something
like
that,
the like, weird world he's coming up with at, like, yes, in his yeah. study hall so, like, period
exactly
or
exactly so if they actually like made like, I don't want to call it like maybe a single player campaign or something like yeah. that, but I feel like if this game was single player, I well, really felt like
is,
I really would
you have
enjoyed
Overwatch
it.
So it's not like you can't have lore and like a multiplayer thing. You've got a
sure
they put some work into that, obviously, not saying that mm-hmm. they don't in this game, but you have, I think also the other thing is like, look, I was that kid, right? Like where I would, you know, I would get done with my assignments early in class yeah. and I would have 15 minutes and I would just draw random lines and whatnot. I was not, yep. I was, it was very innocent drawings. It wasn't vulgar at all. So
see,
it was
the thing.
A different
that's the
style
difference
too,
here.
Right? Where yeah. like this game is very much a bit more like metal, almost. There's a bit of a delinquent vibe, maybe? I don't know if that's the right word.
It's just so immature.
I mean, yeah.
It's just like, it's, I don't know. And
so,
I'm,
so my
maybe,
other question.
Like, we grow up on different places, you know, but it's like, I remember when I was a kid, there was no one who was, like, talking as, like, vulgar as
yeah.
the characters in this game do.
Well, Kansas,
I don't even
to be fair, Kansas was voted most innocent state in the United States, so.
Oh, really? Is that,
yeah,
that
I don't
true?
Know. Sure.
I have no idea.
in our canon, it has become true.
Yeah, exactly. We
so
made
the
it
other
canon.
Question I was going to, because you mentioned, like, you feel like there's a way that this could have been done better.
Mm-hmm.
We had I'll call it a conversation. We had an exchange, per se, off air about a week and a half ago, where we were talking about Bulletstorm.
Oh, yes.
And I feel that the dialogue in Bulletstorm is gross beyond any words I could possibly put together. It is incredibly try-hard and just, even watching a trailer of that game, I can't make it more than 15 seconds because it's just non-stop. To the point where it's just like, dude, like, who wrote this game?
Yeah.
Like, it's insane.
Yeah.
But I also, like, over the past, you know, in 2011, when Saints Row the Third came out and had that same kind of juvenile humor, but it was maybe reeled in a bit, or maybe it was just the way it was presented and it wasn't all constantly in your face the whole time. I still enjoyed that. So I just, my I guess my question is, like, do you think that the style this game is going for, not necessarily the looks, because I think the looks is interesting and really cool, and it is pretty unique, but you think the general, you know, the dialogue, the voice of the game itself, like, do you think that is what's bad about it, or is that the way it's presented, the way it's maybe super in your face all the time and gets annoying, or, you know, do you think there's a way for them to present it in a way that maybe wouldn't have been as bad or as confusing maybe for you?
I almost think, like, it's almost like what you were saying. I almost feel like that's like how it's presented and like how it's in your face as much. I feel like that's almost the same issue, perhaps. I don't enjoy any bit of it. Even if it was just kind of innocent, like, or I'm gonna say innocent, like, even if it was just like maybe mildly there, like some of that immature, vulgar talk they talk about, even if it was just there a little bit, I don't think I would like it. But to the fact that, I guess I suppose, that yes, it's in your face all the time, it just, like, I really like playing Drawn to Death, but just hearing that and listening to that and seeing that, I'm just like, it just really, I just don't know if I want to play this anymore. That it's just, like, and it's just to the point that it's like, I'm just trying to ignore it. And, like, every single time I'm like, yeah, like, I really like this game. I like the abilities. I like kind of like the different characters. I think the weapons are pretty good. I feel the, like, the just the movement in general is really good. Mm-hmm. And then it's just like, oh yeah, like, this is why I don't really care for this game. Like, is these specific things.
Yeah.
That's
my thing where I want to give it a shot, but it really, I don't think I'll like it either.
And if this game didn't have, if this game didn't have those things, I think I'd really be enjoying this game.
Yeah.
I think it's just that how, just how, I'm going to mention somebody. I listened to Dan Reichert on another podcast just recently.
The Beastcast?
Yes, okay. The Beastcast. Yes,
we can
yeah, and I think I think I also watched the quick look that Giant Bomb put up.
Okay.
And his thoughts on this game were pretty much,
it's 2 weeks, not 2 weeks exactly running, we've name dropped Giant Bomb, but go ahead.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay. It's not maybe like exactly in line with mine, like in some of the gameplay spots.
Yeah.
But like he pretty much wraps it up, and like I'm not one to basically just, and you're not either, I think, to basically start literally calling out, like, what this game says and how it says it and stuff like that. A lot of F words, those kind of things. He basically just takes it
blast.
He basically does. Yeah, like, that's the best way to put it. He literally just describes, like, what this game is doing and how it is just, like, not, it's just not funny. Like, the game is trying so hard, I feel like, to be like, yeah, F this, F that. Yeah, my, you know, my dick's out, you know, all this stuff. And it's just not funny, and it's just annoying. And it's like, maybe they do, like, maybe they'll try it once, and then, like, or maybe there was, like, one joke, like, oh, that's kind of funny or something like that. But it's just all the time in your face. And you have this little frog toad thing, and it's kind of like your tutorial guide of like, hey, here's how to do this, all this stuff, and he's just like insulting you all the time. And it's not like GLaDOS insulting you, it's not like you're a horrible person or something like that. It's like, yeah, I took your mom out the other night and she did, you know, blah 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 blah. And it's just like, and a lot of the descriptions as well. So one thing that really turned me off, like even with the tutorial, and like whenever you read like character bios or something like that, or like especially each like weapon has like a description, and it's like you could literally just tell me what the game is about, or assuming like what the gun is about, but they just keep like describing like all of these like stories about like, yeah, well, I used this gun and I took it out with your sister the other night, and yeah, like you're just, you know, and like one of the first things, like right when you drop in the game, you start in the tutorial,
mm-hmm,
and it's something like, well, here's the tutorial, and it's like something about, you know, some insult here, and then it says like, it's something to the effect of like, but if you don't want to be here, you can just press options and leave, and then like in parentheses it says effing idiot, like, you know, full thing, and it's just, yeah, like,
and like I guess it's the thing where I do feel like there's probably a crowd that, I want to word this the right way, because I don't want to feel like, I don't want to say it as if it's insulting to anybody, because I do think that there's a crowd of people who will be like, oh, that's funny. I do think,
yeah,
there are
people who think
it's, yeah, funny. Like nothing against you at all. Like I have a conversation with somebody at work who's like, who likes Duke Nukem a lot. And I kind of feel like, and the same thing with Bulletstorm, like playing Duke Nukem Forever for me, beyond just the quality of the game itself, like also the writing in that game, to me, it really gave me pause and made me think, like, what does Duke Nukem look like in 2017 now? Yeah. Like, you know, and or 2011, that year, the year it came out or whatever. Mm-hmm. I think that was the year.
Yeah, sounds about right.
Because, you know, maybe you hate liberals and social justice warriors, but yeah, as someone who is called those things often, like, in a negative way for whatever reason, but regardless, like, sometimes I think about that, because it is different from the 90s or whatever, when, like, some of that humor was maybe more accepted in video games, I guess.
Yeah.
We're, like, it's not necessarily that the stuff in Drawn to Death is bad, maybe. Possibly. I mean, look, like, Saints Row the Third has a dodo baseball bat.
Yeah.
That you run around, yeah, and hit people with. And it's ridiculous. Yeah. And, like, I didn't really use it much, but it was, like, when it was there.
Yeah, you did. Come on.
I mean, like, maybe one mission. Okay, I'll, you know. but the thing is, like, for whatever reason, and I haven't played that game in a long time, so maybe I can't articulate it well enough. But for whatever reason, the weird juvenile stuff in Saints Row the Third came off, yeah, better. And it was presented in such a way where you felt better about it,
yeah,
than maybe a Bulletstorm or a Duke Nukem or perhaps Drawn to Death. And so I do wonder, like, is there a way to present this stuff in a better light? Is there a way for Duke Nukem, a new Duke Nukem game, to be made, still stay true to that character, but not be, like, super offensive? And I don't really know the answer to that, but, like,
yeah, I would like to see like a new modern, like, Duke, but, like, have those kind of,
I mean, it would probably have,
like,
to be,
those,
like,
super things
self-aware
about him. Well, the thing is that I feel like, and not to go down the full, like, Duke Nukem, you know,
right,
speculation talk, but I feel like they need to get rid of some of, like, Duke's, like, older lines. Because I feel like they do it in Bulletstorm.
Yeah.
The new thing. But I feel like they especially did it with, like, Duke Nukem Forever. That, like, I just feel like he's just reciting a lot of lines that he made in Duke 3D.
Sure.
And it's like, they need to just write new things for him. It's like, sure, we can have kick-ass, chew bubblegum, all this stuff.
Right.
But it's like, I just feel like that's just so, it's it's done to death, we'll say.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to see a new Duke game that has, I'm trying to wonder how to word this. Like, I would still like it. I don't want to be, like, offensive,
right,
but I would almost like it to be, like, borderline offensive, to be like, hey, this is actually still funny, and, like, this is actually making fun of some things that are, like, happening,
yeah,
today.
Or it could be,
and, like, regardless of your political view, you can, like, step back and be like, you know what, that
but
is,
but
like,
it could
pretty
be,
stupid.
It could be maybe be, like, commentary also, like, on the things that he says as well. Like, mm-hmm, I think of some of the issues, not necessarily with Duke Nukem, but, like, when you have characters in whatever media saying certain things that are kind of offensive, I think maybe the difference ends up being, like, how is that character then viewed in that world? Like, are they then, like, are they able to freely say and do things that are, like, super offensive and wrong and get away with it? Or is it the kind of thing where they're present, but they, but the game, movie, whatever it may be, makes a clear effort to say, no, like, that's dumb, or, like, the wag their finger at it, right? And so, like, but I, but so you could have maybe a self-awareness to it.
Yeah, and I mean, I think it'd be funny that, like, if, like, Duke comes out in, like, the new game and says some, like, really, like, sexist thing or something, and then he goes, like, well, I'm kind of an asshole or something. Like, I don't know, just, yeah, like, something along those lines to be, like, that, like, they're not trying so hard to, like, build up Duke as, like, yeah, he's still funny, right? But, like, if they actually maybe gave him, like, a personality, I guess, maybe?
Right.
I don't know.
It's also, you know, we've just... In general, we've progressed, and I'm going to talk about it with Persona 5 when we get there in a second. Like, I just feel like, for me, we've gotten to a point with video games, and, like, specifically video games, where I certainly I love me some Saints Row and just some goofy, weird, whatever, like, games that do not take themselves seriously at all, or games that just don't even have a story and they're just fun. I love me those games. Give me a Kirby game. I don't need no... weird self-aware commentary in Kirby. I just want a Kirby game, you know? And that's totally fine, right? But also, like, I kind of am drawn to games that have things to say, have social commentary, or address things in a new light, ways that we, you know, normally don't talk about things. I like it when games have subject matter that you typically don't see. Because I think one that, like, the fact that we don't see it often is nice. It's refreshing. But I think ultimately, like, in Persona 5's case, like, it brings up things that are important to talk about. And I think oftentimes there's kind of this stigma and the stereotype of, like, the video game player who, like, maybe is sheltered or doesn't get out or, like, isn't socially inept. And, like, I don't think that's true for a lot of people. It might be true for some, but, like, I think in general, like, I play a lot of video games. I feel like I have a pretty decent view of the world, and, like, I think I'm okay. I know how to talk to people, and, like, you know, and I know how to interact with people in a way that isn't awful. But I think also, like, I feel the same way about movies and books too, where, like, they can teach you things, you can learn things from them. And so I also like that I've now started in the past, especially the past few years, have been able to jump into games that also, like, have taught me things. Or I feel like I can come out of a game having something stick with me where I think about it and I reevaluate the way I see that specific issue in the world. It's, you know, Nier Automata maybe isn't something that has, like, a very politically charged message, but, like, it has a message. And I think it's really interesting, maybe not super important right now, but it's something that, like, really makes you stop and think about how you view certain things and cultures in the world. And with that said, if we're done talking about Drawn to Death, I would like to use this opportunity to transfer over into a little game called Persona 5.
I'll give you that moment. Just give me, let me have some closing thoughts on Drawn to Death. I did record a video of this. I might have a video going up. More than likely, probably be next week after this is posted.
So this week.
Yeah. Yes. This week. Yes. This week.
This upcoming week.
Yes. Yes. The week you are listening to this, it should be live. I just feel like this game could have been so much more. But to even just kind of take that and just leave it there is just kind of my final point on that part. If this game was not... So this game has a $20 price tag, and is then free with PlayStation Plus. If this game, and like I was wanting to go back and kind of read some of it over again, if you wouldn't have told me, I would have just been like, "This is just a free to play game." Hmm. It really just feels like a free to play game. I don't know the specific changes that they made from, like, when it was a free to play game to, like, where it is now, but. There's basically things like you can go and you can buy new taunts and stuff. Okay. And there's different I think one of them is like there's different skins you can get for each character that you get a kind of mystery box open when you get 150 kills. Each time you get 150 kills, you get like this key, and that will unlock this box. It's just got a random assortment. It's like, you know, a loot box or whatever. It's got random assortment of just skins and taunts and all this stuff. But you can go into the menu, and for $9.99, you can just unlock all of that right now.
Right.
And there's like some other things where, yeah, like you can just buy whatever skin you want, or you can buy different keys, or you can buy the, I mean, like the thing that's like the God of War DLC pack, if you've seen any of that. You can like have some of the characters have like Kratos skin tattoo, or not that tattoo, whatever that red line that's on his face. But like, there's some like God of War themed items, and I'm like, that's fine. But it's just the things that it just portrays, I just feel like, yeah, this just feels like a free to play game. Like there's not really all that much that I feel like really warrants, like it doesn't feel like, yeah, this looks like a this feels like a $20 purchase that I could make. It really just feels like something that, and like I don't want to get into conspiracy talk, but it really just feels like it's something that, so, hey, it's not free to play anymore, but it's free with plus kind of thing.
A strong recommendation coming from Collin.
I just feel like this game could have been
free on plus
more.
So if the humor that Collin is super offended by sounds interesting to you,
turn off the commentator. You know what I even say, like turn off the commentator. I'd even maybe even can say like just play this game on mute, I don't know. But then of course the gifs of the guy like farting on some dead corpse or something is just gonna be all over the place. I'm just so conflicted with this game.
If you got plus,
don't know.
Maybe give it a shot, but
yeah.
I'm gonna give it a shot. I will play this. I don't know if we'll talk about it afterwards. Okay. Maybe if I have some enlightenment that I want to add to this. But
you're gonna be like, oh, Drawn to Death is incredible.
Colin,
like,
I don't know what you're
so
talking
funny.
About. Yeah,
it's so funny.
All right, yeah, so I finished Persona 5 last night.
Yes, you did.
I have some notes. I just have like a kind of a almost a bullet list point, like bullet point list of things I want to touch upon, because I felt like I didn't do a good job of articulating what I wanted to say about Persona 5. Now that I finished it, though, I'm hoping I can do that. And I want to give this warning. I have no intention on spoiling even minor details about this game, because you shouldn't be spoiled on this. Like I had to dodge YouTube videos and search terms. I had to do everything possible to ensure that
podcast,
I would not
podcast, Twitter,
yeah, that I wouldn't get spoiled for like a long time, especially when it released in Japan, you know.
Oh yeah.
So don't worry about that. I will say I do want to talk about some specific, or not, I want to talk about some thematic, like thematically speaking, some things that the story brings up. I do want to discuss. So if you are sensitive to that kind of stuff, I will say when I'm about to bring it up, and then you can stop listening if you are. I don't think it spoils anything I have written down here that I want to talk about, but just in case.
Yeah. I guess I just don't have a choice, I guess. I guess I'm just going to have to listen to it.
Yeah, you can just, like, hang up on Skype. And all.
It's okay. You know, side note, I think I did. Didn't we do that, like, one of the first PSN Stores podcasts we had? We, like, I'm like, I'm going to put my headphones down for like 5 seconds.
I think there's been
times
before
weird.
Where like someone has been
like that.
I'm taking my headphones off.
yeah. Something like that.
Message
yeah,
me.
Go ahead.
Okay. So
yeah.
The first thing I want to touch upon, kind of talked about a little bit last week, just the general style of the game, combat, some general systems and stuff. One, like this game stylistically, speaking aesthetics, the UI, just the way everything is presented in this game, is I feel like on a different level compared
that
to
UI is really good.
Almost any other game I've played. It is almost like when I finished this, I felt it's like whatever game I play next, it is almost unfair because there is no way it'll be presented this well. Like, and I feel like even Persona 4 like had a pretty good UI, like it had a cool presentation to it, and Persona 5 feels like the next logical step. It's just that the step is so big. Mm-hmm. That it's really remarkable, and like it's so crazy, like going back to that very first initial trailer of just how very much representative that was of the style of the game. Even then, like it's still is presented in that way, like from down to the loading screens, you know, scene transitions, dialogue boxes, like way like parts of the screen will tear apart and you'll see like the character portrait as they're talking and reacting to things. The persona transformations, the awakening scenes when each new party member kind of gets their persona ability, the way those are done. It's kind of crazy because in a lot of these games where you're like, it's a JRPG or something, and like the cinematic cutscenes are like just anime scenes basically. Yeah. A lot of times the anime scenes are like the best part, like presentation wise. It's like, oh yeah, here we go, this is gonna look good. Like I think they still look good in Persona 5, but I feel like it's saying something that the rest of the game presentation wise is even better than those scenes. It's also just, you know, it's not like the best looking game ever, but it is, I believe, running on the Catherine engine, which like that was a pretty good looking game, I felt. So I think this game does look pretty good too. Like, the dungeons themselves, like all have their own unique aesthetic. Which beyond that, like just dungeon design, I talked about a little last week, it's just being very strong. They all have their own like kind of unique puzzles or unique way of progressing through each dungeon, to where it feels like every time you're going into a new palace, as they're called in this game, like, you know you're going to be doing something different. And that is the way it's presented, the way you're progressing, the puzzles, whatever you're doing in those palaces are new, they're different. The person you're chasing down, obviously, is different. So the story arc around it is revolving around a very specific plot device or some new theme that the game is introducing. The music is going to be new, so each dungeon, each palace has its own unique music track as you're exploring, all of which is very good. The confidants in this game, which are basically social links from last games, that's your kind of becoming friends and romancing potentially party members or other characters, all that stuff is done really well. It's the kind of thing where like that's how you're gonna get unique story arcs for each specific character, so you get to learn more about them and kind of get to know them better, and all that stuff is done really well as it's been done in the past. Combat, of course, is pretty traditional Persona stuff. I talked a little bit about it last week. It's still very, very good. I like it a lot, basically. The music, just the general, the whole soundtrack of this game is, again, like, it's up there with Nier Automata. I don't know which one I prefer, honestly. Like, it's kind of tough. But, like, those two soundtracks for me thus far are, like, just so far and above everything else I've heard this year.
Curtis, do I need to remind you that you were in the presence of our Lord Yokotaro?
Yeah.
Just be careful.
I am. About... Yep.
Okay. Just be careful.
And one other thing I really like, and I'm curious what you think about this, and if this is something that you think about when you're playing other games, no matter what they are, actually. So Persona 5 does this thing where, and other Persona games have done this, and it's not really unique to Persona either, which is why I would like to get your feedback on this specific thing, is so in this game, the palaces, these like this other world you go into, it's called the metaverse. And one thing that this game does is it takes a lot of time setting up rules for the metaverse. It explains how you get into the metaverse, what it represents, how a palace is created, what it means if somebody has a palace. It explains the connection between both worlds. It sets up all these rule sets. And, you know, for the first couple dungeons, it kind of follows that rule set pretty well. And then as you progress further into the game, it doesn't break the rules at all. It always follows those rules that it sets up for itself. But it kind of spins it on its head sometimes, or it subverts how you would expect those rules to be followed in some really interesting and clever ways. And so the game benefits from that because that means it's not going to get stale after like three or four dungeons. Because once you get to the third and the fourth and the fifth dungeon, etc., those dungeons are going to feel different. The way you go about doing them feels different. It isn't just following the kind of general setup that you had with the first palace. And so it's something that it stood out to me in other games, but it stood out to me here as well, is I really, really like when games set up certain rules within the story for why things are the way they are. And I always like it when I'm able to see a game take those roles and kind of bend them into some really interesting and unexpected places. And so what I'm wondering, hopefully that explains it well enough, I'm wondering if there's things that stand out to you in other games where you've seen that happen. I think I see it a lot in JRPGs, of course, because the story and the gameplay tend to be pretty intertwined.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering if there's other games you can mention. There's nothing really I can think of off the top of my head.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you could, like, provide an example. Like, do you mean, like it setting boundaries and then it, like, kind of, like, breaks those barriers?
Yeah, so I wouldn't... It sets boundaries or rules, right, for things happening within the story. Like, places you go or the reason why maybe your character is able to do certain things that might set up rules for that. Just for context and for world building, it explains why. So it's not like, you know, in a lot of earlier games, it's like, yeah, you Mario jumps and gets mushrooms because you do that, right?
Yeah,
whereas, sure. You know, we get to a point where we have these larger, grander stories where maybe you need reasonings for why. And it gives context and it maybe fleshes out the world a bit more. And so what I always like is seeing games take those boundaries it sets for itself. And I wouldn't necessarily say break is the right word, but I like they tend to bend those boundaries or they see how far they can get while still staying within their own preset limitations.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that makes sense.
A little bit. For some reason, the only thing I keep coming back to is I'm like, I'm sure there's something in Metal Gear.
Sure. But right, yeah. Like, isn't that the great thing about, like, I guess, you know, there are probably times where Hideo Kojima might just break his own rules, but...
Yeah, he always does, yeah.
But I think you could point to earlier Metal Gear games and say, absolutely, it does, where it's like, where it will, like, go on and on about some crazy thing that you might not understand at the moment, but, like,
mm-hmm.
I do think it is probably setting it its own boundaries, and, like... All of those, like, nanomachines and everything, like,
I was gonna say nanomachines, right? Yeah. Like, yeah.
There's a reason why that stuff is set up.
Yeah.
That
was the first thing that came to mind was nanomachines.
Yeah. So I just really like that stuff because it's the kind of thing, especially with Persona games, it's like when you get later into the game, it's like, well, we can't just have them go into the palace the same way they did the first two. Like, they've got for story reasons, they set it, the way it's all set up is, like, really interesting and different, and it's, like, exciting because, like, the story is building up to a big climactic moment, and maybe there's twists that they throw in. So I always really appreciate that. And it's not just a Persona thing. I think a lot of games, especially games now as we're getting more story-heavy, and I think more care is being put into world-building and giving context for things and... You know, like, a certain gameplay mechanic isn't just there to be there. Usually there's a reason for it. I think, yeah, I think Metal Gear is a good example because I think Metal Gear is the kind of game where every single little thing, there is a reason for it. Yeah. Even if that reason is totally insane, there's still a reason why it exists.
Yeah, and it's like, I feel like it's like almost like borderline like fourth wall breaking a little bit, like because like the things I can think of like in Metal Gear is almost just kind of mostly fourth wall breaking kind of moments.
So
I don't know, like even just I don't know if this is a good example or not, but like one that came to mind was Metal Gear Solid 3 where you're fighting the Sorrow and you're like, oh well, you just died, and then it's like, oh well, you use the fake death pill or whatever, or the revive pill, or I don't know, I just kind of think that like it just kind of you know, takes that, it's like, hey, you know, you're just supposed to live and you're supposed to win, and I don't know,
okay,
just kind of feel like that, just
so
that.
This kind of ties into thematically speaking just different themes that are present in Persona 5. Essentially at a base level, the metaverse is this alternate world that they go in, that is where the Phantom Thieves go into these palaces that exist within the metaverse, and they go in, they steal the heart of whoever they're going after, and in doing that, it causes the person in the real world to have a change of heart and to admit guilt for whatever sins they've committed.
Jeez.
And so, the example... so, basically, here's a point where if you're super super sensitive to spoilers, tread carefully, I guess. I don't feel like I'm spoiling anything. I will talk a little bit about the very first arc, the very first palace, basically. Mm-hmm. But I will try my best not to do anything more than that. So there's just your warning, out of courtesy to everybody who might be listening. The first arc in this game is, it's basically they're going after a person who is, they are like physically abusing, the male students while being very pervy towards female students.
Yeah.
And it's a, and so basically the, it's kind of the thing that gets the whole ball rolling for this group is, when they learn about the metaverse and they learn what they can do, they decide, well, we're going to steal his heart, and that'll cause him to, he'll have a change of heart when we do it, and he'll admit guilt, and we'll finally, like, we'll save these people who are the basically fallen prey to this guy. And it's one of the things that they learn, and it's one thing that I want to talk about, is relatively early on, you get the sense that unlike maybe Persona 4, where Persona 4 is, it takes place in this small town, is kind of the Scooby-Doo detective agency kind of vibe for your party. But it, even though it gets into some very dark themes, and the story gets pretty dark later on, I mean, there are like people being found dead on hanging from telephone poles. Like, it's not a super lighthearted game, but there is an air of like innocence presented, not just for these characters, but just for the world itself. It doesn't necessarily talk about some very real world and grounded things. And so one of the interesting things that this game really, it's almost a scathing critique of just culture in general and the way people behave on a day-to-day basis, where I'm sure you've read stories like this. You hear stories of like, yeah, the person like passed out in a doctor's office or in some location, and everyone just like was too busy just with their own lives, and or like no one called 911 or no one did anything to help.
Yeah.
Right. Like every once in a while you see a story like that. And so one of the things that they learn about this first person that they go after is that it's not like people don't know that he's abusing students. I mean, there are certainly rumors about it, and some people believe, some people don't. But there are very explicitly people who could do something about it who know, but they just choose not to. And some of the reasons is because this particular guy, like, brings a lot of good press to the school. His presence and role in the school is, like, to some people, it is more beneficial to not do anything than it is to actually maybe press charges against the person. And so it's this general like apathy towards wrongdoing, towards maybe political figures who are awful people, or other people in the workplace or school culture in general, where like you just get the sense that there are people who are just so apathetic about, I guess, really anything that doesn't impact them personally, that a lot of people just don't speak up, or they see things and they don't say it, or they don't speak up about it. They don't try to interfere and maybe help somebody who's in need. And it kind of brings up this very like moral gray area for the Phantom Thieves, your group, your party in this game. That they start to question, like, the first couple times they steal hearts, they're, like, they're pumped up, they're excited, they're getting good press, like, more and more people are talking about the Phantom Thieves, and so, like, the fame kind of gets to their head. But as you progress more and more, you get to this moral gray area of them asking, is what we're doing right?
So, like,
is it... Oh, go ahead.
I mean, it just sounds like the Phantom Thieves are just creating a phantom pain,
as perhaps. And that's, well, I mean, you say that like almost as a joke, but like
it kind of, I know that's what you're kind of going, that's what you're kind of going to.
It kind of is the thing that is brought up sometimes. It's like, you know, are they doing more harm than good?
Yeah,
you know, what is the repercussions behind them making these, forcing these people to have changes of heart? You know, like when they do it, you know, these people, they come out, they admit their sins and they turn themselves in. But like, one of the examples, so the first character you meet, his name is Ryuji. He's the first person who like kind of joins up with you. And Ryuji is a former track star. He kind of stood up to the first person you go after before the events of the game takes place. Because he did so, the track team was suspended, basically, from the school. There's no longer a track team, and a lot of his former teammates blame him. And so he's just kind of been, like, looked down upon. He's not, like, he's not super smart, so he's not getting good grades. He's just kind of this loner. And it's kind of the thing for him of, like, he felt so passionately about, like, he needed to speak up. He needed to do something. But doing that cost him his track team. It cost him a potential scholarship. It cost all of his friends on the track team the thing that they do. And so they have nothing now, and everyone blames him for it. And it's something that he struggles with a lot, where here's this guy who's like, I was just trying to do what was right. I was just trying to stick up, not just for myself, but for my parents and for my friends, and look what that got him. And it's this other thing of like, just this concept of not just apathy, but also like these metaphorical chains that hold people down, which kind of ties into apathy in general, of just the way people sometimes like will lose hope, or they'll just see the things that are happening in the world around them and just be like, I am powerless to do anything, so why do anything at all? And it's like, it's a bummer to see, because it's like, it's the thing, like the fan, your group will see that and be like, man, that's wrong. Like, how do, one, are we really like, are the things that we're doing, is it right? Two, can we really make that much of a difference? Like, and three, like, you know, it's this thing of like, they want so badly to be just and to find justice in the world, and to try to make things better, not just for themselves, but for Japan as a whole. And even though through their successes, there are also many failures that lead them to their own self-doubt. And there's also this kind of, one of the taglines for this game was take back your heart. And so you have these characters who all bring with them their own baggage. Your character was falsely accused of this crime, so he's got this he's got this record just kind of hanging over him that he may not ever be able to get rid of. You've got Ryuji, who has basically single-handedly ruined the track team, or caused the track team to be disbanded. You've got An, who's another early character. She is she's a really interesting character, because she's kind of a she was like a foreign exchange student when she was younger. So she's got like blonde hair and blue eyes, which is kind of unique. It's pretty unique in Japan, from my understanding. So there's like that angle. But also like her parents do fashion, like work in the fashion industry. So she does modeling. And so you get the sense that a lot of people kind of see her as a sexual object, where she is more than that. And you've got other characters as well who have their own baggage and their personas that they unlock when they enter these palaces. Like, they are representations of that. And so there's also this layer of them taking back their own heart, taking like owning up their own identity as well, which is really interesting. But without saying too much, like, the game does get very tropey in like JRPG ways. Like, it does have things that are like, I've seen that in every JRPG. But what I appreciate about Persona 5 is that the way it handles those tropes, or the way that it's presented, still feels unique and interesting because of the context of some very, one, just thematically speaking, the things that this game is trying to address, but also very specific issues in society, specifically in Japan, from my understanding. But also, like, it's pretty easy if you don't live in Japan. There are some things that you might not fully grasp, But there are a number of things in this game where you can look at and easily attribute to something that you see in your everyday life. Whether that's certain political figures, whether that's in the workplace itself or at the school that you go to, or even just in your day-to-day life in general, there are things that you probably see and go, man, that's kind of messed up. And then perhaps you don't do anything about it. And so it's like I said, it's a very like scathing almost view, or not a view. It's very scathing, like, and pointed look at society, specifically in Japan. But the way people view what I have written here, it is the way people view and are apathetic towards politics, work, and school culture. In ways where I feel like even when the very tropey kind of JRPG, very generic kind of things enter into the story, I am more willing to forgive them, because when you tie them into the themes that this game is addressing and the way it is doing that, I think it makes them really interesting and very poignant, when you consider how they are also tied into just the entire game's structure as a whole, being as vague as humanly possible. The way this game wraps up is so very interesting. Like, the final, like, encounter, I guess, is like, it is such a fascinating concept to think about, as it ties into the game as a whole. Whereas if the game wasn't about the things it's about, it would just come off as like super trite and weird. This game like owns it, because it is addressing very specific and very real world issues that not very many things address, I don't think. I think the closest you get is, I think, you know, to bring it up again, I think Metal Gear in certain circumstances brings up political issues in a way that isn't necessarily trying to deliver commentary on politics, but it brings up things that you don't necessarily think about. I think if you look at like Metal Gear Solid 2 and you think about the message that game was trying to get across and the things that that game was saying about government and war and politics and any other weird thing, like when you strip away the nanomachines and riding with a sword and you know, all the Metal Gear stuff, but when you strip away that stuff and get to its core, like, even today Metal Gear Solid 2 is super poignant in some like almost scary ways, and like Persona 5 also feels that way. It's like, it is kind of scary how very appropriate this game is for things happening in the world right now. And I bet it would have an even more profound impact on me if I was currently living in Japan, would be my assumption from what I've heard from other people. I don't know what your thoughts are like about that kind of stuff, like thematically speaking, if any of that stuff kind of rings or makes you even more interested.
Yeah, I mean, I love kind of stuff like that. I mean, Metal Gear Solid 2, I think is a fantastic thing.
It is a masterpiece, I think.
It is pretty good.
Yeah.
Even though it's kind of, I don't know. I don't know if it's like looked up like when you talk about like, oh, the best Metal Gears, I don't know if Metal Gear Solid 2 always comes up.
I would bring it up.
That's basically what I'm trying to say.
Without hesitation.
But yeah, like we were saying, the things they talk about, like, who's really in charge, or like, who are the patriots,
right?
And like, the thing with, you know, with, oh, what's her name? Emmerich, mm-hmm. You know, how do you know there's only, you know, this many letters in the alphabet, or, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's like, why didn't, like, maybe just somebody said, like, maybe it was just someone who came up with, there are this many letters in the alphabet kind of thing. Yeah.
And it's, go ahead.
Well, I don't know how much I know too much on that kind of thing. I do like things that seem to be kind of parallels to like what's going on today. Mm-hmm. I really do enjoy those types of games. I'm not sure. It's hard to point to an example.
Yeah,
right now.
And it's also hard to really talk about specifics with Persona 5 and not spoil anything, too. Just inherently because of things that happen and the way those themes are tied into story events. But it is, I think the game has had such an even more profound impact on me just because of that stuff. Because, I don't even know if it's necessarily because it sheds light or it's definitely, it feels poignant in today's world. But I think even without that, even without the parallel, I still think it would be interesting because I just think a lot of the things in this game, a lot of the things that this game talks about or addresses, or even stuff that you kind of see in a couple of scenes and it never really brings up again, all of it rings very true. Especially the apathy that the society around these characters had towards different events. Yeah. It's like, you would do this great thing and like, it'd be great. And you'd be like, yeah, look at this great thing we did. And you just see the reaction or like the falsehood behind the reactions too. Like you get, it talks about you kind of get into the zeitgeist around events. Right. Of like, and sometimes like you have people who are very genuinely excited about a certain thing, but then within the zeitgeist itself, it becomes so big that like, it then becomes almost, fake in some ways. It's,
man, I got one word for
yes.
you, BioShock.
Yeah, totally.
Like just thinking about like Rapture and the. Even with Columbia and Infinite, the voxophones and the stories you hear from people.
Yeah.
And yeah, you're talking about like falsehoods or like, hey, like, you know, just the things that people would do. And like, you know, did they really believe in that? Or, you know, it was so good with like its storytelling of you would get an audio diary from like somebody at the beginning of the game that's like, yes, so we're coming to Rapture. Like, we're so excited. We're going to be captains of industry, all this stuff. But then like you get an audio diary, like by the end of the game. And it's just like their whole world is just fallen apart and how much like everything was a lie. And,
mm-hmm.
I don't know, stuff like that. I don't know if that's kind of where you're going, but
yeah, I mean, I don't want to like be too specific or anything. Like I just, and there are other themes and other things that this game has to say that I don't really want to bring up at all that are more poignant towards the end of the game. I think a lot of the, thematically speaking, a lot of the things I'm talking about are things that you can see in the first few hours if you're just being observant and paying attention. And even the story pretty outright is like, hey, look at this thing. Isn't it messed up? And sometimes it feels maybe a little on the nose. In other cases, it's not. But it's just one of those things that it's so striking because I think we are getting more and more games willing to step into that kind of territory, but it still feels rare in some ways. Especially maybe coming out of a Japanese company, like a JRPG like this, addressing these concerns is kind of crazy. I feel,
mm-hmm.
I feel like maybe you'd expect it like from an indie developer or something at this point.
Sure.
And I do wonder, I wonder, like, if there was trouble of getting these kinds of things approved. Like, when you think about, like, this is a relatively big Japanese developer putting out probably one of their biggest games in their lineup. Like, and from my understanding, like, there are characters that seem scarily similar to certain important Japanese individuals, maybe in politics or elsewhere. So I do wonder. I wonder like if that was difficult to maybe get okayed on certain things. When you start up the game, there is actually I think the series has done it before, but maybe not in the presented in the way it was for Persona 5. When you start the game, it's like it does the whole like characters in this game aren't necessarily representative of real life people. that, you know, Assassin's Creed does it as well. But this game takes it a step further where it's like, you can only go on this journey if you agree to these terms.
Yeah.
And so, like, if you don't, it backs you out to the main menu.
Huh. Yeah, that's kind of cool.
So, yeah, I Persona 5 is awesome. I would like to write... So, here's kind of what I was thinking. I don't think I'm going to review this just because... Not that we haven't had late reviews before. I just don't know what good a review for this game would do at this point for anybody. Like,
yeah,
it's already had super glowing reviews. Like, you know, I don't know if it would do much good. But I really do feel compelled to write something about it. And so I'm thinking maybe waiting a little bit and writing more about this game's story and characters. Okay. And maybe just giving it some time for people to get through the game and maybe coming back and kind of writing more in more detail about that kind of stuff so that people have time to get through it and we can maybe discuss and like you can just have that discussion, a little bit of a deeper discussion about some specific details in the game. Because I think on that like whole scale, I think the game handles a lot of that stuff really well. I mentioned here in my notes, there are some fan servicey moments in the game that it's like, yeah, I guess that's just gonna be there, but it does kind of fly in the face of some character arcs for certain characters where it's like,
yeah,
well, like there are totally like you go to the beach and like that actually isn't that bad because part of it is like getting a certain person to actually go out into society, and so it's like a kind of an interesting, like, it makes sense, but it's more like there are sequences. This isn't a spoiler at all. I think it happens relatively early on. There's a scene. So, On, I mentioned earlier, she's kind of, like, I mean, she does modeling. Like, she's a very, like, attractive person, but, like, and she's tall, right? Like, got a good figure and everything. But Ryuji and Morgana, the cat, throughout the game, make comments. Morgana, every time he addresses On, Morgana just goes, "Oh, Lady On. I'm nice," because Morgana's like convinced, whatever. But there's a scene where like you're all, the whole group is like hanging out in your room discussing things, and there's like a futon, and On like kind of like is about to pass out on the futon, and Ryuji and Morgana, it's this so subtle and like, I remember seeing it and thinking, is that, what are they doing? They like both lean over and I guess try to look up her skirt. I don't really know. That's what I took from it. But it was like this really subtle thing that just happens. And I just was so beside myself because I'm like, what are you? It just felt super against, or just, it felt like it was flying in the face of An's character arc. Mm-hmm. And it was like kind of, I don't know, it was weird to see because it's like, you guys, you're so close. But there are scenes like that, there are sequences like that where it's just like, I know this is being played up for laughs, but I mean, it's not, this doesn't really need to be in there. Whereas it's weird to say that, whereas like, for once, I think the like beach scenes actually kind of make sense within the context of the story. I don't think there's really much wrong with those for the most part. But anyways, Persona 5 is great. If I was going to review it, it would like near be one of the easiest 5 stars you could give. Okay. Collin.
Yes.
See, Persona 5, I have a harder time like just throwing out there being, you gotta play this game, because I understand it is a time sink, it is a time commitment. Whereas Nier is not nearly as long. Nier is like a third of the length of Persona 5.
That count all endings?
Yeah, at least all the main endings. Sure, you could probably get through the true ending of Nier Automata in like 30 hours.
Oh, you know.
Which isn't, like, I don't know. I get sounds alike a lot, but when you consider that
Excuse me while I go pour 100 into the ukulele.
Right, like ukulele is probably going to be like 20, I would bet.
Yeah, I'd say so.
You know, it's
something. Like that.
So I think 20 to 30 usually isn't too bad.
Yeah, it's not as probably big.
Whereas
as
Persona 5 is like 3 times the length of ukulele of a Nier. So yeah, it's, you know, it's a little harder to just be like, yeah, you should just play that game, which you should, but understandably, some people are not going to have the time immediately to do so. But you should play Persona 5.
So I've got one more question.
Okay.
And this could raise my hype index like 10 to 15 points,
okay,
depending on this answer.
Yeah.
I really like Life is Strange. Would I enjoy the high school aspects of Persona 5?
Sure. Okay. I think, yeah, like, I think there is, you know, half of the game is that stuff. Half of the game is being social with your friends and hanging out with other people. Like, and it's not just your friends, like your group, the Phantom Thieves. It's not just them that you're hanging out with and raising confidants levels with. Like, there's a doctor character. There's a fortune teller. There's like a journalist that you meet up with. There's some other people as well. And one, like the way they tie back, they take those characters who are like not really relevant at all, and they actually find a way to tie them back in and have them make sense. And like just the name Confidant itself like fits with the game as well. Like the idea of these Phantom Thieves. All that stuff is done really well, and that is fun because a lot of it is very like it's very text heavy, and it's a lot of like making the right choices to, you know, like thinking about who you're hanging out with and like what would they want to hear, you know, to raise your confidant level with them. And then so for all the girl characters, when you can raise it up to 10 for anybody. So for the girls, like if you raise it up to 9, you can say something to enter like a romantic relationship with them. Which doesn't necessarily mean a whole lot. There was a few extra, like you could potentially go on dates with them and have like kind of like sort of innocent little romantic sequences.
Yeah.
Where they say like somewhat innocent things, and then it fades to black and it's like you spent a romantic evening with whoever.
Yeah.
And that stuff is cool. But But see, that's where you get a lot of the story for each individual character, or at least anything that wouldn't be present in the main story. So like, there are characters where, like, you want to max out these confidants with these characters because you want to learn more about them, you want to get to know them, you want to help them with whatever issue that they have. So I'm trying to think if. Like Ryuji, for instance, I guess is maybe the best one to say is like Ryuji's the issue he deals with is his regret over what happened with the track team. And so in the process of getting his confidant rank up to level 10, it's kind of helping him through that and where that ends up leading, basically. And so not only are you getting like some really interesting stories for characters and some really good character moments that are, I think you would like, reaching certain levels with each confidant unlocks special abilities in battle. So it kind of ties back in and on itself. But that's like half the game. And it's really well done.
Well, I was even going to ask, like, which aspect do you think you enjoyed more? The kind of, like, more combat stuff or the, like, high school?
I don't know. I think it's probably relatively evenly split.
Okay.
Like, both elements are done really well. Like I think now, like even the dungeon crawling is the best it's been in the series. But you know, I think both of those aspects are done really well. It's the social aspect is very much like time management too, because you have like, you can do one thing during the afternoon, one thing in the evening, and going to like a dungeon takes up a day. So you've got to kind of like, keep that in mind because there are like deadlines for when you need to complete a dungeon before something bad happens. So it's there is like that element, so they're tied in together pretty well. And then there's the whole like persona fusing stuff too, which is, it's a whole other discussion.
Yeah.
With Igor and the Wardens.
So, if you had to make a pick or a nominee from Persona 5 for Whitey the Dolphin's Character of the Year, who would you nominate from Persona 5?
See, it's tough because for us, historically, Whitey the Dolphin's Character of the Year has been a serious while also kind of jokey...
Sarcastic.
Yeah, yeah. Sarcastic choice. So for Persona 5... That would be tough because I'd have to think about it from that angle.
Okay.
But I think in general, when you look at all of the different confidants, of which there are quite a bit, all of these different characters that you have like relationships with and friendships with and stuff, and get to know, I think all of them are like, for the most part, all of them are going to be characters that stick with me. Especially like, and even more so, your main crew that is your party members, like every single one of them, I really, really like a lot. Morgana, I love. Morgana is the best. A lot of people don't like Morgana because Morgana is like basically as the cat that kind of hangs out with you and stays in your room. Morgana in this game is given the role of being like, hey, you have already done what you should do. Like, if when it reaches evening, you have like one thing that you can do, and then you go to bed. Mm-hmm. And so if you've already done that one thing and you try to do other stuff, Morgana is like given the role in this game to be like, hey, you should go to bed. Hey, you can't. Yep. You're probably too tired after that. You should go to bed. So some people have kind of lashed out at Morgana for that. But I like Morgana quite a bit. I don't know. I really don't know, though, as far as like a Whitey the Dolphin Character of the Year nominee. I think I would be more willing to give it to a Nier Automata character at the moment.
Oh, sure.
Specifically, oh, God, it's killing me. Why can I not remember this character's name? In Nier Automata, there's a robot you meet.
9S.
No, starts with an S, I think. Oh my God, what is his name? Anyways, you meet you in Nier Automata, you find this like friendly robot village, and there's a robot there. Pascal. Doesn't start with an S. His name's Pascal. I think I'd be willing to give Whitey the Dolphin's Character of the Year to Pascal at the moment. Pascal, honestly, man, not to get too off topic right now, Pascal might have like one of my favorite character arcs for a character in a very long time.
Awesome.
It's really good.
Yeah.
You should play Nier in Persona.
Probably. It's how like the last like 3-4 podcasts have ended of like you should just play just Nier.
Yeah. Get to Persona at some point.
So I know I just keep coming up with questions.
I mean, feel free. Yeah, like show. I mean, hey, it's fine.
The only one I'm sure I can maybe come up with another one later, but the only other one I've got right now is after completing the game, do the 7/7 streaming recording video restrictions from Atlas make sense?
No. But I don't... One, it's... I think... Don't... Seeing this, if you see the 7/7 date, don't go in expecting 7/7 to be like, oh, July, when
this
I,
big revelation
to be like a big
something.
Moment, story moment. Yeah. It's just basically at that point you will be done with like the third story dungeon.
Mm-hmm.
So like, gotcha. In that respect, it's like, I guess like at that point, there are some things that happen in the story that's like, oh, this is interesting. This is it would be an example of them taking the rule set that they have established themselves with and maybe bending it in an interesting way. That's kind of around the point when they start kind of playing around with that kind of stuff. Yeah. But I guess we talked about it before last week. I still just think that stuff, I don't think it's going to change. I don't think they're going to lift any of those restrictions, unfortunately. But I still just think it's like, I still just think it's really tone deaf and missing the point. Yeah. Unfortunately. And I don't know really I don't know. And you know what? Perhaps I am falling into my own trap. Perhaps I am becoming too apathetic towards this specific issue. Maybe I should be willing to step up and say, yo, these are really dumb restrictions. Like, yeah. I get it. I totally, like, I understand why you, like, are careful about spoilers and that stuff. But maybe also, like, I don't know. I heard it said elsewhere of, like, you could have the game come out and everyone be talking about how great it is and how amazing it is. And that certainly is happening. Or you can have it come out and people talk about how dumb your restrictions are for a week.
Yeah.
And, like, that may not have a huge impact in the grand scheme of things. But I bet you there would be people who are maybe on the fence about Persona 5. All it would take is a stream or two. Now, granted, some people are streaming. You can find videos of the ending on YouTube. So I don't know how much they're really going after this stuff, at least right now. But it's still, to me, it's more like, just the thing that really got to me was the threat of their restrictions. Yeah. Of the threatening people if they broke certain things. It's strikes, like, come on, man. Like, I get it. Like, maybe, like, for the first week, they're like, hey, maybe, you know, be careful about streaming past this date. But, like, at some point, you should just be like, look, you stream the game. Like, whatever. Don't monetize it, I guess. Like, if you're really that particular about it, sure, but...
Do you think, like, at the end of the year, when we're talking about, like, the great games of the year, do you think the discussion will be like, oh, hey, let's talk about Persona 5, and then it just immediately go into, oh, yeah, no. Remember those really
And that's why I think, in some respects, it's already died down, right? Yeah. You know,
I'd say so, yeah.
Week and a half after launch. Almost 2 weeks after launch, if you're listening to this, and like, I don't really hear anybody talk about it, at least on Twitter and other places. Like, there you go, you know? And like, the end of the year, at least for me, like, it's hard to imagine that come the end of this year, Nier and Persona 5 will not be like my top two games of the year. Pending. Nino Kuni 2, I guess.
Knack 2.
That's going to be the one. Can you believe that part where, like, in Knack 2, you get to the end and the entire end, like, it's really something that the entire end sequence of Knack is you're running down these series of platforms, doing crazy jumps, dodging explosions, and it's against a timer. And basically the goal is to hit a button to stop a nuke from launching from director in charge Rump. It's really something. I mean, it's the last game I would expect to have any sort of commentary, but...
Well, that's what just makes it great,
though. It does, right? It really elevates the story of that game to a different level. Knack 2, please be excited for
Yeah, I just wonder where they're gonna take it after
for Knack 3, right?
After that, I just really want to get Mark Cerny on the phone and just say, like, with the great, you know, masterpiece that was the original Knack and the storytelling that you made,
and Knack 2, like the way that they escalated things.
How many more individual objects can you render on Knack this time?
Yeah.
With the PS4 Pro. I don't know.
Anyways.
Yeah.
That's been a podcast.
It has been.
Oh, man. Sorry. That has been a podcast. Collin, thank you for joining me, as always.
You're welcome. That was a long one tonight.
Yeah, happy Easter.
Yes, happy Easter. I for some reason, was always thinking it was the
happy
next
late
weekend.
Easter, I guess, to people.
Yeah.
If you celebrate Easter. If not, happy week.
Yeah. I will say this.
Hi.
There was some, like, Easter update in Drawn to Death.
Oh, God.
And you can do different taunts. But I will give this game credit. There is a taunt that all that says is Happy Easter. And I'm like, I just can't believe
the, that's the restraint.
Exactly, like they're exactly like you got all these taunts that are just so like degrading, and then there's just one that's just Happy Easter.
Can you give me a screenshot of the Happy Easter taunt so I can use it as a thumbnail for this podcast?
I will do my best. I will actually try that. I will see if I can get that for you. Yes.
Please do. Thank you for listening, as always. If you haven't, please play Nier Automata. You can contact us at PSN Stores on Twitter. You are at Bossman C. Crowder. I am at PS Penguin. You can write to us, podcast@psnstores.com. If you have questions, corrections, thoughts on anything that we've talked about in this episode, of which there was a lot.
Yeah.
We have a giveaway.
Oh, that's right.
If you have listened to this podcast all the way through, here is what I need you to do. I need you to write a comment. We'll say a comment on the YouTube video. Just to keep it all localized. First two comments. There were two codes. It's for a game I reviewed a couple weeks ago. Nightmares from the Deep 2. The Siren's Call. You may remember us talking about it on a previous episode. We have two extra codes to give away. Here's what I need you to do. I want you to write in the comment a fun fact about Davy Jones. It could be real or fake. You can make it up if you want. But write a comment on the YouTube video of this podcast, a fun fact about Davy Jones, and you might win. You will probably get a one of these extra codes for Nightmares from the Deep, which is a cool kind of adventure, hidden object, puzzle game.
I've got one. Did you know?
Okay.
Davy Jones had a locker.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, the Davy Jones locker. Yeah, you know. Yeah, he had a locker. Fun fact.
Weird. Did you I got one as well.
Okay.
Did you know so Davy Jones, a prominent video game player, as I'm sure you're well aware.
Yes.
Yeah, his favorite game, you're not going to believe this. You know what his favorite game of all time is?
Assassin's Creed 4 Black Flag.
No, you're close though. It is actually Sonic the Hedgehog 2006.